I do think it is time for everybody, in addition to the town council, to take a good hard look at this issue and make, come to a decision on their own, and we'll see what the will of the town is. I do want to have an explanation, if I can. I've heard discussion tonight about a 20-year bond in the language before us that would have final maturity, I'm on the one, two, three, fourth paragraph in the first page of this. Final maturity not later than the year 2018, which appears to be more than 20 years. Is that just wiggle room or?
It's wiggle room. It will be a 20-year bond because the state statute requires that a project of this size be a 20-year bond. The purpose of the wiggle room is that you would bond this at the end of the project. The project is due to go to 1996. Okay. Not knowing what might happen, it was left with wiggle room, to use your term.
Not later than, in other words, you can do it before.
You do it before if you do all the, if all the project costs were in. You know, hopefully, it would be, that's a terrible word, hopefully. The desire is that it be less than 11.7, but this would authorize it up to 11.7, required to happen by then.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other discussion? We're ready to vote. All those in favor of the motion? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 0. Thank you.
I would just like to make a comment for the room, Mr. Chairman. I still think that there's people out there that's going to agree with my interpretation of the first paragraph in this point.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Item number 54, to consider a report from the Board of Sewer Appeals relating to sewer policies and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the Board of Sewer Appeals has been working very diligently for months, meeting several times a month, and has come up with a new proposed direction in our sewer policies that is really forward-thinking and is really a turnabout in many respects from what we have been doing. Last month, the council authorized a contract amendment with the for the water district to have with the city of South Portland to expand our capacity of the South Portland treatment plant. The remainder of the report, their recommendations indicate that the town should begin an aggressive program to reduce sewer infiltration and inflow, spending down a little bit of the sewer surplus, and thereafter spending $100,000 each year to replace antiquated sewer lines so that we don't get into a situation that we have a massive project that instead we do a little bit each year. That there should be tough enforcement of sewer infiltration and mitigation of that, that there should be fines when roof drains go into the system, that the cost of sewer upgrades and improvements should be borne by new connections to the system and not by existing sewer users, and projections have shown that is possible. That we should watch very aggressively the water district to continue recent cost containment efforts. Met with them several times and they seem very receptive to this at this point in time and had some good discussions. The committee has looked at several drafts of this. One of the changes in a late draft is that they're recommending the town study alternative sources for sewer system management, including privatization and or contracting with another community. They're concerned that we may not be getting the best deal from the Portland Water District as we could be. They also would like to see sewers go into those areas that are designated as growth areas within the comprehensive plan, with the planning board still needing to determine what those growth areas are, and then ultimately by the council. They feel there should be aggressive enforcement on the maintenance of private septic systems, and that we should be providing more informational material on a steadier basis to people who have septic systems and to new septic users. As I indicated at the beginning, this is a new direction, and it results in a tremendous amount of work by the committee. And you know, if this is moved forward, we would then be working with the sewer committee to come up with some specific language recommendations to implement it, and it's, you're also, it's recommended that you refer it to the planning board, consideration of providing a recommendation to you on where the growth areas specifically ought to be and what resources ought to be used to direct growth to those areas where growth is more preferable and away from those areas where it is not desirable.
Thank you, Mr. McGowan. Any questions of the town manager?
Do we have anyone from the committee here?
I had thought that there was going to be someone, but there isn't, so that's why I
wanted to make sure they were recognized if they were here.
Yeah.
I think they've attended so many meetings that...
They're watching at home.
Perhaps, yeah.
Councilor Jordan.
Do you want comments tonight, or would you like to have a motion that we have a workshop with the sewer committee on this? I prefer the workshop because I have two or three questions that I would like to hear their answers on. What's the feel? Nobody cares.
What are your questions?
My question is, do we have a workshop on it? Or do we adopt it as it is?
We're not adopting.
We're not adopting tonight.
We're not adopting.
We're receiving.
Yes, Councilor.
If I understand this, we are accepting the report. Would be passing part of it to the planning board that is pertinent to them.
I don't have a personal preference as to what you might do. You know, it doesn't matter if there's a workshop or whatever. If you do want to, you know, begin to move forward, you'd want to do something like acknowledge receipt of it, and then the staff would work with the committee to prepare different things that come out of this report, but nothing would happen without it again returning to the council. But you know, this is a, maybe I will give my viewpoint, this is a major issue. It's been one that the citizens have petitioned the town on several times, and I think it would be helpful for the council to meet directly with the committee and have a good exchange of views.
Councilor Jordan?
I'll move that we accept the report with many thanks to the sewer committee, and I would like to have a workshop with them because I'd like to discuss roof drains. If somebody had purchased a house which had already been hooked in, who do you find? The original owner or the guy that said, no, I'd like to go over that a little bit because I'm not in favor of it.
I could answer that one now, but
I think we'll just wait. Yes?
I would second Councilor Jordan.
We have a motion, second, a discussion. Now, Bill, by your motion, all we're doing is accepting this and...
Thanking the committee, yes.
And we're looking for a workshop with the appropriate parties, okay?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin, I knew it was coming. You were thinking there.
You can smell the rubber burning here. I think the sewer committee has done a monumental job on this. I know they spent many long hours, and I am very appreciative of the work that they did, having helped to get this initiated last year. I think it would also behoove this council to include the planning board if we do have a workshop with the sewer committee. I think if we can get everybody at the same table at the same time to discuss some of these very important issues, and as the manager has indicated, there are some very major changes being proposed here. We would be looking at our ordinances, doing some of the work that we expected sewer policy to do in the past. And I think that I'm at this point, and I'm in favor of following that direction, and I think this work also will help us move along with some of the recommendations and work follow-up work that the town needs to do with our comp plan. Now, I see that as a very healthy outgrowth of this. I just am delighted with the product we have received. I know there are some very good discussions that we have to follow up on this, and the sooner we can get going on it, the better.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Councilor Coggeshall?
The subject of infiltration has been discussed randomly by the council for over 4 years, so I hope we have a workshop very soon so that we can decide if this is the direction we want to go in and start it, because it is going to be a long process.
if we vote to accept this and then have a workshop on it with the appropriate parties invited, why, we can set that workshop date up when we meet Wednesday night. So we have a motion that we do that, and it's been moved and seconded. Any other discussion? Councilor Dalbec.
I think, based on Councilor McLaughlin's input, you need to amend the motion to be a meeting, a workshop with the planning board and sewer committee.
It's fine. I thought appropriate parties was enough, but that's okay. We can amend it. So we'll make it that we'll accept it and have a workshop jointly with the planning board and the sewer advisory.
Okay, we're receiving
How's that? Further discussion? Yes, Jen.
Could I clarify the terminology we're using? Are we accepting this or are we receiving this?
Acknowledging receipt.
Acknowledging receipt, I believe, is the first step to take in this process. Just, I don't want to get caught doing something that we don't want to be doing tonight.
Would you amend that again to acknowledge instead of accept?
I think it was.
Was it?
No.
Did you say acknowledge?
Acknowledge receipt.
That's what I thought I said.
Okay, you already got it.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Item number 55, to consider a proposed municipal state agreement for a traffic light at Spurwink Avenue, Route 77, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Is there a plan on the back of that, Lee?
Yes.
No, this one here.
The flip.
We're coming back, Mike.
I'll be back. There was a plan on that board. Somehow it disappeared today. This is following forward on the traffic light that the council approved about a year ago at Spurwink Avenue and Route 77 at the South Portland end of that intersection. There's actually two intersections by that name. This would put a traffic light at that intersection. It would be activated by traffic with coils that go in the road. The state has engineered a plan. We have had it reviewed by the gentleman who probably maintaining the lights to make sure that it's going to be good functioning system, low cost to maintain. He assured us that it would be. Some of the actual, for example, the control box would be field located. But overall, having had Public Works look at this and that engineer, it looks like a pretty good plan. And you had indicated you would like to see it again, and this is it.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Entertain a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move
Councilor McLaughlin.
That we approve the municipal state agreement regarding the proposed traffic signal installation at the intersection of Ocean House Road and Spurwink Avenue at the South Portland, near the South Portland line.
Second.
Seconded by Councilor Coggeshall. Any discussion? Councilor Dalbec.
Yes, when this first came up, I was against putting the traffic light at this intersection. I still haven't seen justification in my mind for a traffic light at this intersection, so I will be voting against.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Councilor Coggeshall.
It's a related matter. When we first discussed this, there were funds for a traffic light at Scott Dyer and Ocean House Road, and you were going to follow up to see if those monies could be used to redesign the intersection. Have you heard anything from them on that?
Not specifically.
That's a good answer.
That can mean anything. Mr. Malley has seen this also, is that correct?
Yeah, Bob has reviewed this.
Any other discussion?
You have written to them.
Pardon?
No, I spoke to him.
Okay.
I didn't write to him.
We have a motion. Do we have it seconded? Mm-hmm. We do. All those in favor? 5-1. Thank you. Item 56, to consider authorize authorizing payroll deductions from main share and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. A little while ago, Matt Howe, who is executive director of main share, approached me to see if Cape Elizabeth might be interested participating in this umbrella organization that raises funds for about 21 different organizations. I did take up the issue with our personal advisory committee, which is a group of employees from each department who attempt to represent the views of the different employees in their department. They did indicate that they would like an additional choice beyond the United Way to see perhaps that they might like to donate through payroll deductions. I did have a concern that, you know, where do you stop offering the ability for payroll deductions? You know, from every group wanting to come forward. And really, looking at the issue, decided that we really don't have a policy for determining the United Way itself is an organization that has any policies governing it as far as the town. So what I did was draft up a policy and procedures for Cape Elizabeth Town Employees Combined Charitable Appeal. This is based somewhat on some similar policies in other communities, and what it provides is the independent relationship of the town to the different groups that we don't really endorse them. It provides how an organization could become an umbrella organization, how it could participate in payroll deduction, that it would have to have at least 15 groups, that there would be certain standards to qualify in order to remain as a group. There are certain reporting requirements. They have to have certain IRS certificates. They have to file certain reports with the IRS. A lot of boilerplate type stuff. The campaigns would be done at the same time for the United Way, plus for Main Share or any other group that came forward. It would be done in the fall of the year. There would be no direct cost to the town. Obviously, there is a cost in terms of the just sending, processing a check each month and sending it, as well as the time when we have the joint appeal from the different groups that come forward for those employees that choose to attend that. So, you know, I would recommend to you that you adopt the policy and procedures, and Mr. Howe from Main Share is here should you have any questions specifically about Main Share.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. You got any questions of the gentleman from Main Share, or would you like to give us a motion, or would you like to just talk about it? Councilor McLaughlin.
I do have a question of Mr. Howe, please.
Yes, go right ahead.
I know that United Way traditionally conducts its campaign in the fall. In fact, they have their kickoff tomorrow, I believe.
Right.
Is this the traditional time for Main Share to be conducting their program?
It is.
Also?
We conduct our campaigns generally at any time between Labor Day and Thanksgiving, and what we try to do is accommodate employers and recommend that Main Share campaigns be run simultaneously with a United Way drive, and that there not be two separate campaigns, but one simultaneous combined drive, which doesn't take additional employee time, and is really the same process which has been going on in the workplace for many years, but with additional materials, or in some cases modified materials, which provide combined brochures and postcards offering the various options that have been introduced.
Do you, I'm wondering if you promote, how different would your promotion of your program be from what United Way does?
Well, as you can see, the 21 groups within Main Share are not part of any United Way organization in the state. So our, just to backtrack a bit, the key distinction between Main Share and United Way is that all of Main Share's member groups are working on a statewide level. They must be having statewide impact to pass our eligibility standards. And the reason for that is that the United Way is organized locally throughout the state. There are 9 United Way organizations in Maine based in the primary population centers, and they are doing a fine job of funding direct local health and human service organizations. Main Share emerged to represent a segment of the nonprofit community which previously has not had access to workplace campaigns. And the primary reason for that is that those organizations don't have a specific community which they serve. Instead, they are working on a statewide level Examples are the Maine AIDS Alliance is working throughout the state to develop support groups for people with AIDS and HIV positive, and working to develop HIV education programs, not just in Portland or Bangor or Lewiston, but in every county in the state. So I think there are very clear arguments, which most of are familiar with, for the need not only for local responses to problems, but to statewide responses to the chronic problems in our midst, such as sexual assault and domestic violence and toxic pollution and so on, all the many the issues that our organizations are addressing.
Thank you for that. I'm not sure if you can answer this one, but would it be possible for a town employee through United Way to specify one of the Maine Share programs?
That's presently an option. As I understand, the United Way of Greater Portland is introducing a program called Donor Choice, mm-hmm. in which if an individual is familiar with an organization that they want to support through payroll deduction, they may write that in the bottom right-hand corner of their United Way pledge card. What Maine Share requests is for, we are not a single organization, we are a federation of 21 organizations. And we realize that employers can't take requests from specific agencies to be added on alongside United Way. But we are coming together as a whole community of groups under one umbrella to offer employees a distinct new choice and a distinct designation program. One of the limitations of donor choice, and it's not to diminish its importance, it's a great addition, and it allows employees who give to United Way to better have more latitude as far as where their United Way dollars are going. Number one, it doesn't give employees information about Maine Share, and it doesn't enable employees to participate in our designation program. As you can see on the pledge card, one may make a gift to Maine Share as a whole, and that's a contribution shared equally among the 21 organizations. Or one may pick and choose and designate four or more specific agencies within Maine Share. So with the United Way card, you could only write in one agency. You could probably write in more, but it doesn't cater to that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Other, yes, Councilor Carvajal.
Mr. Howe, all the funds stay within the state of Maine?
Yes, they do.
Mm-hmm. That was my basic question of your. My other question is of the manager. United Way has sort of a competitive type of approach, in fact, that they like to have 100% participation. Are the employees going to be kind of pressured for the sake of the town to join United Way over Maine Way, and did they ask that they have other choices other than United Way?
The employees, when the question was posed to them, did say they would like an additional option or choice. We have never pushed for 100% participation in United Way. We really don't try to put that much pressure on employees. Whatever employees give is kept confidential from everyone in management. While we encourage people to be supportive, what follow-up there is done by payroll, like the payroll type people, just, you know, did you remember type thing, you know, for those, particularly for those that have given before and haven't, there's a reminder, but it's kept very anonymous, and there certainly is not pressure for 100%.
Councilor Dalbeck.
Question for Mike McGovern, and that is on Chapter 5, Item C, campaign period. We've got October 1 concluding no later than December 1. Recognizing that the United Way campaign is kicking off tomorrow and usually kicks off by the middle of September and typically concludes during the first week of November, how would that impact that?
This really says they couldn't come here until October 1. United Way, Maine Share, anyone.
It is. How'd you pick these dates?
Actually, I think I took them right out of the Augusta policy, the City of Augusta one that I use. Nothing magic about that. If you want to change it slightly, it's no problem. What I don't want is for one group to try to be coming in during one time, another group another time. I really see one meeting that United Way can give their pitch, Maine Share can give their pitch, and wouldn't have been a pace setter campaign, United Way, anything like that. You know, obviously that would require the dates.
For consistency's sake, I would move that. Maybe if you want to start, do everything on the 1st, I'd be saying September 1st and November 1st.
That's fine.
Other discussion? Other questions of Main Chair?
We don't have a motion.
No.
We may have some discussion after.
All right. Can I get a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we authorize the policy and procedures for the Cape Elizabeth Town Employees Combined Charitable Appeal as presented to us.
Thank you. Second?
With the revisions of starting no earlier than September 1 and concluding no later than November 1.
Counselor McLaughlin can make that motion. I can certainly feel safe seconding that motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Counselor Marvin.
I think that this puts undue pressure on the employees despite what Mr. McGovern has said to us. I've been in a situation where I've seen these type of programs, and I think that it's difficult for employees to make decisions and feel comfortable about them. I think it also will cost the town a lot of money. It takes time away from the workplace. There's more and more secretarial and staff time that would be required to take care of the pledges. And I think the donor choice gives them the option and that they can give individually to any of these places on the main share listing, and therefore I will vote against it.
Counselor Jordan.
Just to follow up on a question that was raised, is somebody going to volunteer to do this? Do you have volunteers, or is this going to be a paid situation?
There's no paid situation. Each year, I try to recruit one employee who opens the meeting and encourages employees to give. And that's a volunteer. Some years, I admit, I have to do a little arm twisting, even, you know, for the existing situation. This year, particularly.
Counselor Dahlbeck, you had a question?
Your Dahlbeck.
Yes, as I guess most people know, evident from my pen, I am a United Way supporter, and I do feel that on balance, the United Way serves the community very well. However, I don't feel I should attempt to dictate my feelings to the employees as long as they end up with enough support for this main chair approach. And I think the proposal by the town manager is a very well-balanced proposal. And as a result, I will end up supporting his proposal.
Thank you. Councilor Cargill?
I just wanted to, Mr. McGovern, we already have payroll deductions, or we do not?
We do for United Way.
For United Way, okay.
All those in favor, we have a motion and seconded ahead of us. All those in favor? One, two, three, four. Opposed? Two, 4-2. Thank you.
Thank you very much. While I'm here, could I give you brochures for your employees?
We have some.
Thank you.
But enough for all town?
Yeah, if you just leave them up here, I'll see that they get them.
Item 57.
Thanks, man.
To consider a vacancy in the position of Appointments Committee Chairman and take any necessary action upon the resignation of Wayne Pearman, having to move and leave town. We have an opening, and I would like to recommend to the council, Councilor Janet McLaughlin, as the Appointments Committee Chairman. I'll so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. We don't need a discussion on that. All in favor? 5-0.
Thank you, my fellow counselors.
Yeah, we don't need a discussion.
We'll discuss that for another half hour.
You might if I let you get away with it. Item 58, to consider the annual MMA mail ballot and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
The great thing about this is my name is not on it. I'll be the past president. That comes automatically. I would like to use the opportunity to mention that the MMA Executive Committee is at the Inn by the Sea this evening. I would have joined them had we not had this meeting, and I'd like to welcome them to the community and the council. Some of you or all of you may be joining them at a later point during the meeting, and they appreciate the support. I don't like to say specific times, and they really appreciate the support that Cape Elizabeth has shown for the Municipal Association throughout the years, and particularly this past year. And I appreciate it as well.
We also appreciate your priorities tonight.
Perhaps they're watching on television.
No comment.
Thank you, Mr. McCullough. What do we have to do with this?
You also need to have a voting delegate for someone who's going to be there at the meeting on October 14th, on a Thursday morning, I believe it is. It's in the morning sometime.
Would anybody like to volunteer to be that voting delegate?
It's a Thursday.
Well, that's certainly a very wholesome.
Where is it going to be?
Holiday Inn.
Holiday Inn.
Portland. Oh, Phyllis.
9 a.m., October the 14th.
I have to travel.
What day is it? Monday? No.
No, Thursday.
It's usually a Thursday.
Let me just check.
Business meeting on a Thursday.
October 14th, huh?
Fine.
14th is Thursday.
13, 14. Yeah, that's the first hockey game of the new Portland team. So I can do it that morning unless somebody else would like to. Okay, thank you. And with your approval, I'll fill in this mail ballot and give it to Michael. And Bill, would you like to be the alternate, Bill?
But if you're going, okay. If you're going, I'll be the alternate.
Okay. Could you make that out and give it to Michael? Thank you. Item 59, to consider rescheduling the regular October Town Council meeting.
Mr. Chairman, I think we need to take some action on that item 58, sir.
We need to vote approval of the...
All those in favor of me going over in the morning, say aye.
No.
I move that we approve the MMA ballot as presented, with your being our representative to vote.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Don't anybody dare vote against it. Fine. 6-0. Item 59, to consider rescheduling the regular October Town Council meeting to Wednesday, October 6th, 1993, and take any necessary action.
Yeah, the reason for this is that the following Monday is Columbus Day, usually changed to Wednesday, and due to the MMA banquet, one of the MMA activities, maybe not the banquet, being on that evening, and the town clerk also being unavailable that evening, you'd be without a clerk and a manager. So I would appreciate consideration moving it to October 6th.
Councilor Dahlberg.
I will move the change of the meeting to October 6th.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? Everybody put their hand up, please. 6-0.
Thank you.
Item number 60. To consider setting a public hearing on a revised general assistance ordinance and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the state legislature revised general assistance this past session after the administration had originally proposed eliminating the program. They did still want to see some savings in the program, so they made several changes in state statute that now ought to be reflected in our general assistance ordinance. The Maine Municipal Association, as a service to its members, prepares a general assistance ordinance each year, has it reviewed by the Department of Human Services, so every municipality doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. So I would encourage you to set this for a public hearing at your October 6th meeting.
October
6th.
It seemed to me a few years ago we had this a similar type of document brought before us, and we decided, because of the involved ordinance process that we had, that we had a resolution that we would abide by this particular thing unless amended. Can we not do that again? We could still have a public hearing, but have acceptance as a resolution instead of an actual ordinance.
That's correct. You still do need to adopt it after a public hearing by state statute, but it doesn't need to be an ordinance. It can be, as you've indicated, regulations.
Okay. In that case, I move that we set this for public hearing Wednesday, October 6th at 7:30 p.m.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those, I'm sorry, Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A question to the manager. I would like to know what kind of review there's been by any town staff of this document. I always have a concern we get something from any other agency that's a model ordinance for the entire state, and if there are parts of it that need to be tailored to our own situation.
I have not given an extensive study. The only area I would change is the mileage reimbursement amount that is shown in the plan. Beyond that, I'm a little hesitant to do a whole lot of tinkering with it because of the oversight of certain agencies of these guidelines and the potential of legal challenge in the interest of avoiding lawsuits. I think it's important that we adhere to the state statute as much as possible. Beyond that, it is structured for Cape Elizabeth in this region in terms of Cumberland County housing costs, and all those are recommended by Jeff Herman, a paralegal at MMA, after he has reviewed it with the Department of Human Services, or whatever they call that department now. I think it's still Human Services.
What kind of change would you be looking for in the travel allowance?
It reads 28 cents in here. I think it ought to be reduced to the same amount that's paid to municipal employees.
And what is that?
24.
One concern I had with it was I think it's a positive change they've made is for the fuel allowance, for heating fuel in particular, going from a financial amount to a gallon amount. But I'm not totally comfortable, and I just need to say this, with some of the presentation of that. I think that still can be improved upon, but I'm not hearing that there's any grand desire to work on that. I don't think anything in here is going to be bothersome for us at all. I just do have some hesitancy when there is an overall ordinance for the entire state. And if time warranted, I'm not sure that we need to pay a lot of attention to it. But I do have some hesitancy still.
Councilor Cargill.
In the introduction, there is a comment about how much municipalities are going to be losing because of this new formula. Do we know how that is going to affect us?
The formula change is primarily affects the larger communities. We will still be reimbursed for 50% of our out-of-pocket expense. We're
and
not
we
reimbursed
have been
for administrative.
50% before? Or
we
more?
Have been for about 4 years. Prior to that, the state law didn't provide for any reimbursement for communities that had as small a general assistance budget as we have.
Oh, all right.
It mainly hit Portland, the larger communities, about 28 of them, I believe.
Okay. You happy?
You're all set to vote.
I know we are. No more discussion? All right. All those in supporting the motion, please raise their hand. We have 6-0. Okay, thank you. I'll entertain. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Have I got any citizens out there that would like to address the council on an item not on the agenda? Yes, sir. Come on right up.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Richard Davis, Spurwink Avenue. I'm here to speak tonight about a private golf club, Paputa Club, on Spurwink Avenue, Cape Elizabeth. And I'm here solely speaking for myself. I'm not authorized to speak for Paputa Club. I've been an officer of Paputa Club 25 years. I'm not currently an officer. I've belonged to the club for almost 30 years. For the last 3 years, there's been comments by members of this council concerning alleged discriminatory policies against Paputa Club, and also discrimination against women in playing privileges at the club. And I can tell you as a fact that this has upset a great many people in the club. It's upset many good men and women both of Paputa Club. It has ranged not only throughout the state of Maine, but even outside the state of Maine. And so I'm here as one member of Paputa Club, speaking for myself, and I hope echoing the sentiments of many good men and women on the club about this practice and about comments that have been made by this council. Now, the first thing I'd like to mention is that, and I'm quoting from local newspaper, but the first remark was made in 1991 by a member of the council who was critical of the club for having more convenient playing times for men than for women. Last year, 1992, another member of the council brought up a lack of women on the seven-man governing board. She also compared Saturday morning tea times for women and men. And then in 1993, another member of the council was critical of the club for prohibiting women from golfing on Saturday mornings. Now, I'd like to set the record straight as far as I'm concerned in this matter. First of all, I think all of this started to come about really for two reasons. One was that in 1991, there was a change in the state law so that if the Maine Human Rights Commission found that a club had certain discriminatory policies, they could investigate those. And if there was a finding that they did in fact exist, this information could be passed on to local municipalities, and that could be considered in any liquor license application. And as a matter of fact, it could be used to deny a liquor license application. Those particular facts, to my knowledge, have never come before this council. The other factor that brought this about was a meeting of Papoota Club that was held in 1988, which was, I think, more widely attended probably than any meeting that the club has ever had. And at that meeting, the club adopted a bylaw, adopted several bylaws, but one particular bylaw was adopted concerning tea time for men and women at Papoodic. And if I may, I'd like to pass a copy of that to the council.
Thank you.
One of the basic problems that a lot of golf courses have today is that a lot of people want to play at a very limited period of time. And this was the problem at Papoota Club. Now, Papoota Club is owned by 350 stockholders. Now, I am a stockholder. I'm a single stockholder in the club. There may be another member of the club that may have a family membership. That person can be a stockholder, but there can only be one stockholder in that family. But his wife may play golf, he may have several children that play golf. And so when we add all of these people together, there's far more than 350 people that are trying to play golf at certain prime times at the club. So what the club did, it formed, there was a committee in the club in which women were represented and in which women participated in drafting this bylaw, which was passed by the club at this particular meeting. And if you'll note, in the second paragraph, it mentions that this meeting was held on November 10, 1988. And then if you drop down to where it states the article in the golf course tee times, you'll see that it states clearly that the Board of Governors shall have the authority to determine tee times, which tee times shall be fair and reasonable and shall not discriminate between men and women stockholders. The following tee times shall not be changed by the Board without the approval of the stockholders at an annual or special meeting. Now, what I did, I drew these circles and arrows so that as a council, you can draw some comparisons as to what happened here. On Thursdays and Saturdays, you'll note that they're identical. They're different days, but they're identical. Only women can play at Papoodic on Thursdays up until 1 o'clock. On Saturdays, only men can play until 1 o'clock. Now, I've been in the club long enough to have some instincts as to how the Men and Women Think and Papoodic Club, and I believe if the women voted on changing those tea times now, they would not do it. I believe they would stick to their Thursday date. As a matter of fact, I've had several women at Papoodic tell me that. Now, you can argue that a Saturday may be a better time. You'd have a hard time convincing me of that, because I don't even play Saturday, because it takes 5 hours to play a round of golf. And many women have their husbands playing on Saturday morning, and they would prefer them to play at that time. Since December 8, 1988, when this amendment was passed by the club, to my knowledge, there's never been any movement whatsoever by the women of Papoodic Club to change these tea times. If they had been, I'm sure they'd be considered. Now, if you look under Thursday, where you see Friday, which is a critical playing time, between 11 and 1, it's open for men and women stockholders. Not everybody can play then. You have to be a stockholder. You have to be an owner in the club. If you have a family membership and the husband's a stockholder, the wife can't come out with the children and play at that time. There is not enough time for everybody to play when they would like to play. Then you drop down to the last two dates, Sundays and holidays, and you'll see that on both of those days, it specifically states men and women stockholders can play on those days. Now, currently in the club, there are 349, well, currently, this is within the last 2 months, 349 stockholders in the club. The club is dominated by single male. There's 179 single male memberships. There's only 24 single female memberships at Papoodic Club. And despite the vast majority in voting, and there are family members too, there's 141 family members, there's never been any attempt, to my knowledge, in the time that I've been in the club, to discriminate against women at Papoodic Club. And, you know, frankly, I mean, I take umbrage at it, and I've watched the comments for about 3 years now, and I felt it was time to tell the council, you know, what's happening here, and to try to urge the council not to interfere in a private club. We're really, outside of a very limited area in a liquor license, where really this council has no business. Now, there was a letter written in 1992, after one of the comments, and I thought it was a superb letter. It says, it's titled, "The Ways of Private Clubs Should Not Govern Local Should Not Concern Local Government." And if I may, I'm going to read it. I know it's late, but to me, this is just as important as the school issue, which this council spent a couple hours on. In fact, in many ways, it's more important to me. And I think I speak for many members of the club when I say that. This letter states, "I was most disturbed to read club chided for discriminatory policy in the November 7 issue of the Cape Courier. The story reported that several members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council are or have been concerned about the policies of the Papoodic Club. This club is a private organization that can govern itself as any other private business or organization can. If women believe that the club policy of scheduling tea times is discriminatory, they have the power to respond by influencing the club board members to alter the policy. Placing candidates sympathetic to their position on the board or choosing to no longer support the club by declining to renew membership. Under no circumstances should the town council or any other political organization become involved in this perceived problem. Would the members of the town council and some of their constituents raise concerns if they did not like the double coupon policy at a local grocery store? Would they raise public concern if they did not like the pricing policies of a local cleaners or restaurant? In each of these cases, they would limit their options to trying to convince the management to change its policy or to patronize a different establishment and perhaps convincing other customers to change with them. In fact, there are few areas, far fewer than most politicians and their constituents realize, in which any agency of government should become involved in any issue. Government cannot solve every perceived problem by every resident of a town, state, or nation. Government is force, and this force must be used sparingly. The first rule of thumb must be that the internal affairs of private organizations, whether clubs or businesses, that rely solely on voluntary support by free consumers must be free from threatened or actual interference from government. Under no circumstances should the force of government be used as a substitute for the conscious free decisions of patrons on a daily basis. If you as an individual do not like the policies of a business or club, fight to convince enough other members or consumers to change them. Do not, however, use the force of government as a substitute for the judgment of these voluntary actors. Do not use the force of government to limit an option that other people choose freely because you do not like that option. William G. Stewart, South Portland. Now, in closing, I'd like to suggest to the council that if you have any problem or with Paputa Club policies, that you have someone check into them and not publicly be critical of the club. And in conclusion, I'd like to point out a few of the things that the club does for this community. The Rotary meets at Paputa. There's banquets there sometimes of municipal employees. There have been firefighter banquets, of which my own son attended a couple years back. The club pays I think, $30,000 or so in real estate taxes, and apparently that may be going up 12%. The club provides a lot of open space, and I believe I'm correct that the Cape Elizabeth track team, the Cape Elizabeth golf team, and the municipal employees on their annual outing all use the facilities of Paputa at no charge. And I think the club is glad to do these things and is glad to be a part of the community and contribute to the community. But I respectfully ask the council to be careful in the future in comments such as the type that have occurred here. They may seem innocent when they're uttered at a council meeting, but believe me, they're not. I mean, they cause a lot of hurt for many people in Paputa Club. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other citizen discussion? We'll close that part. I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Moved and second that we adjourn. All those in favor? Now please stay. We're all set. Please stay in session long enough to get rid of this other small piece of...